Who's the little lady who's as dainty as a dream? Who's the one you can't forget? I'll give you just three guesses. Annette, Annette, Annette.
Today, when people think of me, they think of those ears, those wonderful ears.
Doreen! Bobby!
Even 40 years after she put on those ears and that sweater, the memories are still very much alive for a generation who watched and for a grown-up Annette.
I love it. I don't remember being this small. I don't remember ever being this small, but my gosh, I look at something like this and the memories just come crashing through.
We're the Mouseketeers. We want to say hello and give three cheers for all of you who see us every day. You're okay, so welcome to our Mouse Club. And by the way, while you're here, you're all the guests of the...
As far back as 1955, she stood out from the crowd of children on a new television show called The Mickey Mouse Club.
It's time to meet the Mouseketeers.
Roll call.
Cheryl.
Bobby.
Annette.
She was the 24th and last Mouseketeer chosen, the only one discovered by Walt Disney himself, and the only one kept under contract to Disney after the Mickey Mouse Club was canceled.
K-E-Y. Why? Because we like you.
What did the Mickey Mouse Club mean to me? Well, I always say I owe everything to those ears. I mean, it meant everything to me.
Annette grew up under the scrutiny of the public eye and gracefully moved from being America's child sweetheart to teen idol, to movie star, to real-life mom pitching peanut butter in TV commercials.
Now that's nutrition any mother can love.
In the 50s and 60s, Annette symbolized wholesome, innocent romance.
I love you.
Oh, that sounds so wonderful.
She is the perfect girl next door.
She was the girl next door.
The perfect girl next door.
I think the basic quality that Annette has is wholesomeness. She is the girl next door.
She was the embodiment of a generation of adolescent dreams.
She was just beautiful. I just fell in love with her immediately. She was so innocent and sweet, very nice.
She was very sexy, but she was also, I can only speak for myself, she was the kind of girl that you would like to keep forever as your wife, as your woman, but you'd also be proud to take her home and have mom and dad meet her.
Annette Joanne Funicello was born October 22, 1942. Her parents, Joe and Virginia, called her Dolly. They still do.
I was born in Utica, New York, and lived there for 4 years, and then we made the move to California.
The bitter cold winters and not the call of show business drove the family to pull up stakes and go west, all the way to Hollywood and the sunny beaches of California.
My dad is a mechanic, and he just got tired of working in the snow and the weather conditions, so just on a whim, he said, let's move to sunny California. And my mom said, great. So we did.
Show business was the farthest thing from the minds of anyone in the Funicello family. As a matter of fact, a fortune teller once predicted to the family that Annette would someday grow up to be a famous entertainer. Well, the family had a good laugh because no one could imagine that shy little Dolly would ever be able to perform in front of strangers.
I was very shy as a child. My parents tell me that every time the doorbell rang, I used to run and hide, either under my bed or in the closet. And that's basically the reason I started dancing lessons.
Her mother taught herself to sew so she could make costumes for Annette's dance recitals. Easter week 1955, a dance school recital at which 12-year-old Annette is the lead in Swan Lake. As fate will have it, a very important spectator is in the audience.
Walt Disney was in the audience one night because he came to actually visit a friend who was the conductor of the Burbank Symphony Orchestra. So he just happened to be in the audience, happened to see Annette, and found out what the dancing school was, called them, and had them come in for an audition.
Most of the kids that were chosen weren't professionals. You know, they were kids from dancing schools, or somebody had recommended somebody, and it was pretty much an open audition. There were like 5,000 kids that auditioned for the Mouseketeers.
It's such a trick of fate that Annette got into show business, that she became a Mouseketeer.
Out of the 24 children to be cast for the Mickey Mouse Club, there was only one spot left.
The suspense was finally broken when the Disney people phoned shortly thereafter and told my mother that they would give me a 2-week tryout to see if I got along with the other kids.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
On July 17, 1955, Disneyland was dedicated during a nationwide telecast from what used to be an orange orchard in Anaheim, California. Also on that day, a group of children were introduced, and for the first time, the viewing public heard the term Mouseketeer.
And now from inside the theater come the Mouseketeers, a group of talented boys and girls who will be on the Mickey Mouse Club show this fall.
On that day, no one could have guessed the height of stardom Annette would reach.
Who's the leader of the club that's made for you and me?
The Mickey Mouse Club debuted on Monday, October 3rd, 1955. A group of bright-eyed, smiling children charmed their way into homes across the country.
It truly was a fabulous experience. Every day at the studio was like being at Disneyland.
It was such an impressive day to me. Going to work at Disney Studios was like a dream for a 9-year-old kid. And I was going to make a living as a singer and a dancer and with all these talented kids around me. And I was going to heaven.
First of all, we all loved singing and dancing. So it was wonderful that every day we got to play and sing and dance. We had no idea what impact the show was going to have.
Annette had made it into the group that appeared in the opening number, but there'd already been weeks of rehearsal, and the children had almost had enough time to get over the shock of the hats they'd been told they had to wear.
Hats. The Mouseketeer hats, they were something else, weren't they? They cost $50 each, and we were supposed to always keep track of them. They were molded to our heads, so they were only supposed to fit us.
What were these? We all wondered silently, each gazing at his or her funny-looking black felt beanie, topped by a pair of big round mouse ears and the circular Mickey Mouse Club insignia.
Annette was paid $185 a week for appearing on the Mickey Mouse Club. During production of the show, Annette lost 3 pairs of ears. The $150 that it cost to replace them was taken out of her paychecks.
The mouse ears were priceless because they became our trademark. And when you're 12 years old, you're not thinking about watching out for things. And everyone wanted a hat, so you really had to keep track of it because if you looked away for a minute, those things disappeared. And once they said that it was $50 an ear, you know, we sort of paid more attention to that.
With their hats firmly in place, the Mouseketeers took the TV ratings by storm.
The show was an instant hit. The first day it was on television, it like doubled the ratings of the other two networks combined.
I don't think any of us were prepared for what happened with this show. It just took off like wildfire, and it became the number one children's show in America.
Right away, she was the most popular Mouseketeer. All the Mouseketeers loved her. All the boys loved her, you know. She was obviously the most charismatic without trying. You know, she was just automatically so attractive and charming and sweet.
Hi, Mouseketeers. Do you like poetry? I do, especially when it has something important to say. I read a sonnet by Gil George the other day. It's called Talk Happiness. I hope you like it. Talk happiness and let your own world know that you at least find joy in simple things. The springtime melting of a winter's snow, the gentle flutter of a robin's wings. Talk happiness. Say all is well with you, and happiness herself will make it true. Mouseketeers, I think these are wonderful words to grow by.
She wasn't the most beautiful girl. She was cute. But there was a sparkle with Annette that I don't think any of the girls had.
I think she was at one point getting about 6,000 letters a month. And not only was it boys who were writing in, but it was girls. She really appealed to both. For boys, you know, they were falling in love with her. For girls, you wanted to be her best friend. And she just had a unique quality.
It wasn't long before Annette started to outgrow her mouse ears, and the studio allowed her to act in serials that aired during the Mickey Mouse Club show.
We shot Spin and Marty on a ranch away from the studio.
It's kind of a funny deal, isn't it?
What?
Oh, you know, falling in love and getting married and things like that.
I think it's sort of nice.
I developed a terrific crush on Tim Considine.
I heard from some of the other kids that this one Annette had a crush on me. And I thought, how about that? Little 13-year-old kid, you know. And I wasn't at all interested in her. Well, then, a couple of years went by, and she really kind of bloomed. And then I started to fancy her, you see. But by that time, unfortunately, the crush had worn off, and she couldn't see me either.
Because they were children, the Mouseketeers had to go to school on the Disney lot.
Annette sat behind me in school. We went to school in little red trailers.
Our tutor, Mrs. Jean Symon’e, was a great teacher whom I admired and still consider a very good friend.
I always had to search for a mistake before I put an A on so that somebody would know that I really had looked at the paper, because they were so beautifully done.
And just to prove that Annette wasn't getting preferential treatment, here are some of her high school graded papers. We did manage to locate one B among the stack of A's. Schooling on the Disney lot was very serious business, regulated by California child welfare laws.
We had to keep track of the time because with adding up the days schooling, they had to have a minimum of 3 hours by 4 o'clock.
We had to go to school 3 hours a day, an hour lunch, and they could only work us 8 hours, so that left 4 hours of work. So that had to be concentrated effort.
While you're here, you're all the guests of the Merry.
In all, 360 original episodes of the Mickey Mouse Club were filmed. And even after the show was canceled, the shows were syndicated in rerun. And many of them are still available on tape as home rentals today. And between all the performing and all the schooling, there was also time for some romance among the Mouseketeers.
Lonnie!
I had a crush on Lonnie. He was actually, I think, the first big crush that I ever had, and also gave him the first kiss.
I was really in love with Annie, and got her a ring. Just at that time, it was fashionable to get cameo rings, sort of, you know, I had like a knight in some kind of dark gray material. And I gave it to her at a party with a chain, you know. And in the 50s, you have to jog your memory. In the 50s, this is kind of racy stuff, you know, because we were young kids. And I gave her this ring at the party, and she thought it was terrific, and she was really happy, and she showed her girlfriends, and they were running around in little groups, giggling and making fun of the situation, enjoying it. And then she showed it to Joe Funicello, her father. And Joe was not going to have any of that at all. So she gave the ring back to me. So we went steady for about an hour.
Most of the Mouseketeers who first met on Studio One on the Disney lot in Burbank back in 1955 formed a strong bond with each other that's lasted a lifetime.
Those of us who were in roll call from beginning through the end, through the years we'll all be friends, sort of rang true. We're like a close family. Some I don't see as often as others, but when we do, it's like it was yesterday. Annette has remained my very best friend. We've gone through marriage and divorce and children, and you trust someone, and it's hard to build that trust along with new people.
After four highly successful seasons, word came down to Studio One that the Mickey Mouse Club would be going off the air. And the very last episode, show number 360, was filmed.
Now it's time to say goodbye to all our company.
At that moment, I would have given anything just to stay there forever.
Because we like you.
I remember the last day of shooting. Annette and I think, went through two boxes of Kleenex, a box apiece, and we were shooting reaction scenes where we were supposed to be happy watching a circus act. And we had a very rough time with that because we were crying.
We thought it would go on for a couple more years. I had a car payment to make. I was hoping it would go on a few more years.
It was a sad day, but we knew it was coming. So some of us braced ourselves pretty good, but the girls let their emotions out pretty well.
I think it's often been said that it went off the air because the kids were getting older and so forth. It was actually some sort of a dispute between Walt Disney and ABC Television, and it had to do with negotiation for various TV shows.
But the end of the Mickey Mouse Club was not the end of Annette. During the filming of the last season of the Mickey Mouse Club, she got to star in her own serial.
It was a great surprise that a serial was named after me. It was something different than anything I had ever done before.
And while she was splitting her time between Mouseketeer duties and appearing on the Annette serial, she was asked to sing a song.
How will I know my love?
The plan was to have Annette just mouth the words and have a professional singer record the actual song later on. But once again, fate had a major script change for Annette Funicello's life.
No one thought much about the song, and I thought even less of my singing. Apparently, a lot of people disagreed, because the day after the episode aired, thousands of callers from all over the country wanted to know where they could buy my record. My record? Mr. Disney asked to see me. I'm signing you to a recording contract, he announced.
Upon release in 1958, the single sold several hundred thousand copies, and Annette was reluctantly a singing star who would now have to spend a great deal of her time in the recording studio.
Well, Annette never fancied herself a singer. I think to this day that she would say she's a better dancer. But in my mind, she became a very good singer.
Walt Disney brought in acclaimed record producer Tutti Camerata to help fashion Annette's singing career.
I was so young, and of course I was so nervous. I was always nervous when I had to sing. And just the fact that Tutti was there to support me and the Shermans were there to help make me laugh.
The Sherman brothers, Robert and Richard, were employed to write songs for Annette.
You guys knew how nervous I was. And you were so supportive.
Well, you see, the trick was, you know what Tutti said to me? He said, anytime she looks like she's a little worried about the song, you go and sing it for her. She knows she can sing it better than you. So that's how come I sang the songs.
Is that why you used to sing?
Of course. You could always beat me, and that would be the best part of it.
I did laugh. I really did.
I know you
did. I did.
But Annette's singing career was no laughing matter. Tall Paul was her first top 10 hit, and in all, she's released 17 albums and 31 singles, 5 of those were top 40 hits.
I love Tall Paul. Everybody thought it was for me, so I kept walking up boxes and walls and things.
You know, everybody always says, is that Tall Paul, Paul Anka? And Paul and I were dating at the time, I believe, but no, it wasn't. And besides, he's not very tall.
In the late 50s, Annette became romantically involved with Paul Anka, another teen recording star.
Yeah, we had a very serious relationship for a while, and I'd never dated anyone in the industry, you know. And I was like 2 inches old, you know. I mean, how long had I been in this business? And we had a very warm and affectionate and at times emotional relationship.
I was crazy about Paul when we were, very, very young.
The teen idol couple began working together, and Paul started to write songs for Annette. One of them turned out to be one of his biggest hits.
And they called it Puppy Love.
He wrote Puppy Love with us in mind, because everybody said, this is not real, you're too young, it's only puppy love. But at the time, you truly think you're in love.
This is not a puppy love. Someone help me, help me, help me, please. Is the answer up above?
Eventually, the pressures of their separate careers ended their romance.
We rarely ventured out together on a date, for fear of being recognized and sometimes mobbed.
At times, fans would even bring scissors to concerts in hopes of getting close enough to snip off a bit of hair or clothing.
And I think it was just, they wanted to get close to her, and we had to form a cordon, you know, with our arms just to keep the people away.
Perfect couple in an imperfect world, right? We, you know, went as far as we could till we realized that, you know, there were just other things in our life, and like everything in life, it's timing. And but it was, you know, it was great for while it lasted. We remained good friends after that.
Annette was, as she admits now, too busy for a serious romance. Not only with her television and recording, but she'd also made her entrance into the big screen. At the age of only 15, Annette got a chance to appear in her first feature film. It was a real dog. The Shaggy Dog reunited Annette with Tim Considine from the Spin and Marty serials.
Well, I like to see everyone happy. Thanks, Allison. You're a real dog.
Just days after finishing The Shaggy Dog, Annette was on the Disney lot when she got one of the best surprises of her life.
Walt Disney knew I had the world's biggest crush on Guy Williams, who played Zorro. And I guess it was common knowledge around the studio. And for my 16th birthday, he handed me a script. And I said, is this for me? And he said, yes, you know, welcome to Zorro.
This bold renegade carves a Z with his blade. A Z that stands for Zorro.
Diego, the most exciting thing in the world has happened to me. I've met Señor Zorro. He saved my life. But you probably won't believe me. It's so fantastic.
Little Annette was growing up and outgrowing her Mouseketeer image. In her last of 3 appearances on a Zorro episode, she even got to dispatch the villain with a sword. And in 1960, Annette graduated into her first starring role in a feature film. Annette was cast as Mary Quite Contrary in Babes in Toyland.
I can remember the first day that I met her, actually. We had a long rehearsal period. And I had heard so much about her. I had watched her on The Mouseketeers, and I had heard so much about her from other guys, you know. She was just like all the other 16 and 17-year-old girls her age. She used to love to get on the phone and talk about boys to her girlfriends and giggle. And I think every red-blooded male in America was in love with Annette. There's no doubt about that.
The little girl next door had moved uptown. Through the early 60s, Annette was a full-fledged celebrity, and it was then she formed strong friendships with other teen idols.
We really spent every weekend together doing exactly what the movie magazines, it's hard to believe, but what they said was true was true. We talked on the phone every night for hours. We talked about boys every night, every weekend for hours. We ate chocolate fudge cookies in her bedroom for days. They were wonderful years.
The first time I met Annette was in 1958, and we were playing the Hollywood Bowl. We were on the same bill.
We were both performing. We both had hit songs. So there again, it was love at first sight.
I asked for a date.
Yeah, we dated a little bit. We did. But our relationship turned into one of just best friends.
And in 1963, these two friends would form one of the big screen's most popular couples.
We've got to do this right.
Right, there's nobody else in the whole world.
That's right, nobody else.
Just you and me.
Walt Disney himself had given special permission for Annette to make Beach Party, a non-Disney film, with one request, that Annette not wear a bikini that would show her belly button.
The chemistry really happened the first day of the first shot of the picture of Beach Party.
It did work well together because we were so close, and the chemistry was there.
Beach Party started filming in March of 1963, and was finished in only 15 shooting days.
When we filmed on the beach, it was early in the morning and always shiveringly cold, especially after they'd hose us down so we looked like we just came out of the surf.
Beach Party had a budget of $300,000, small, even for 1963.
Beach Party, it was a little picture, and no one really expected that much out of it. But it did come out, and it grossed, I think, somewhere around $12 or $15 million.
Between 1964 and 1965, Annette would appear in six Beach Party sequels. One of them, How to Stuff a Wild Bikini, didn't have Frankie Avalon because of other commitments. But even with a new co-star, Annette was Annette.
She was very wholesome. She was a very wholesome actress type. You know, a lot of actresses aren't. They'll do anything. Like I said to her one day, why don't you wear a bikini? Because this is what the pictures are, girls in bikinis. And she said that because she'd worked for Disney, she didn't feel it was proper. So I respected that.
In 1965, Annette married her agent, Jack Gilardi.
One evening, I don't know what happened. He looked at me and I looked at him, and suddenly we knew we were in love. We shared the same basic values and had the same ideas about married life. Soon, I was wearing a 3.5-carat diamond engagement ring. Because I believed I would marry only once in my life, and because Mom and Dad never had a formal wedding, they went all out for mine.
Among her bridesmaids, Shelley Fabre, and her longtime friend Arlene Ludwig from the Disney studio.
It was a wonderful day. It was a beautiful wedding. I mean, it was a very warm Italian family wedding. It was like my sister getting married.
There was just such excitement. You know, this is real kind of thing that I think bridesmaids do when they're all together. And that's sort of, I remember just being in the house, and the next thing I remembered was being in the church and, you know, getting ready to walk down the aisle. And I remembered her brother was my escort down the aisle.
Nine months after their honeymoon in Mexico, Gina Gilardi was born at St. Joseph's Hospital in Burbank, across the street from the Walt Disney Studios. 5 years later, Jack Gilardi Jr. was born. And in 1974, Jason rounded out the Gilardi family.
Remember me, Annette Funicello? Would you believe these are mine? And Skippy, that's our peanut butter. They love the taste, so it has to be Skippy.
But the picture-perfect family from the commercials had some real-life problems.
I began to see that marriage wasn't as easy as cutting the wedding cake. Looking back on the experience, I have to confess, I didn't really know how to make it work. I didn't know how to be a real partner or how to give and take.
Annette and Jack were divorced in 1983. To the public, she appeared fine, but all of a sudden, after so many years of having someone take care of her personal and financial affairs, first by her parents, then by the studio, then by her husband, Annette found herself on her own.
Although nearing 40, I had never once balanced a checkbook. I didn't understand how the mortgage worked or how and when to pay the property taxes.
A few years after being a single parent, Annette was reacquainted with Glenn Holt, whom she had met many years before.
I was training horses, racing a few horses of my own, and her parents had bought her a horse. I think maybe for her 18th birthday. We had both been married and divorced, and I was still racing horses. And our relationship just grew to the point that one day I asked her to marry me, and she said yes.
Glenn proposed to Annette on Valentine's Day, 1986. They were married shortly after that.
It was one of the greatest days of my life, you know. It was almost unbelievable. We had a small wedding, just mainly some family on both sides.
Among those wedding guests, Annette's three grown children, Gina, Jackie, and Jason. In 1987, Annette Funicello agreed to appear in Back to the Beach, a spoof of the beach party movies she and Frankie Avalon had made more than 20 years earlier.
Not many people can cha-cha-cha. Not everybody can do the twist.
It was during the filming of these scenes that Annette knew she was not completely healthy. She was having trouble with her vision and sometimes could barely keep her balance.
I started to panic. Suddenly, my own body seemed beyond my control. I was telling it to do things and it just wasn't listening.
When we were doing scenes on the beach, she would kind of teeter a little bit and lose her balance, and then we'd laugh about it, say, you know, the old legs ain't what they used to be.
She had first started to suspect that there was something seriously wrong 10 years earlier, as she describes in the audiobook from her biography.
It was late one evening in 1976, and everyone was asleep except me. I was washing my face at the sink in the master bath when suddenly the room grew dark and started spinning. I heard loud crashing bells that sounded so real I had to cover my ears even though the sound was coming from within. After one step, I tripped and went flying headfirst into a large heavy dresser that was ornately carved with sharp points. Everything went black. I have no idea how long I laid on the floor, half unconscious and moaning.
Shortly before Back to the Beach was released, and after years of testing and numerous medical consultations, Annette was told she had multiple sclerosis. For 5 years, amid rumors and speculation, Annette kept the secret of her illness from the public. Even her closest friends didn't know for sure.
It was tough watching her go through this, and she never let on to me what was happening.
She wants no one feeling sorry for her. She's, and she gives you no room to feel sorry for her.
Since 1990, Annette's physical condition deteriorated from having to use a cane to using a walker for support to needing a wheelchair. and she's chosen when to break the news to each of her close friends. The illness that has all but crippled her has done nothing to dampen her spirit.
I feel the love. I truly do, and especially now that I've gone public with my having MS, I feel it more than I ever have.
She's really fighting something that's completely devastating, you know. But her dreams, she's always been that kind of a person. I mean, she doesn't have a bad bone in her body.
I really mean it when I say there's no one else quite like her. She, long before this illness, but certainly in the face of this illness, she moves up here someplace, you know. She's, she has infinite grace. And, she touches my heart. Ooh.
She's founded the Annette Funicello Research Fund for Neurological Diseases to help find a cure for MS and other similar illnesses.
Letters from all over the world, when they found out that she had this disease called MS, I mean, from every foreign country there's letters come. Every day there's letters. People want to help find a cure for this thing.
Her public appearances have grown more and more rare.
Were able to fit my whole last name on there. Oh, that's great. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Annette says she doesn't want anyone to pity her. She just wants people to remember her love of life.
She is an inspiration to me because of the courageous way that she handles her problems. She's a role model.
That's what Annette is. She is just one of the unique, sensitive, beautiful human beings.
This lady is very special in everyone's lives. Was and is the kind of person I think I'd want my kids to be. Loving, caring, wanting to give more of herself than to take. They broke the mold when Annette was born.
Well, I know Annette was America's sweetheart, and I think America was very smart to pick her as their sweetheart. I mean, she still is America's sweetheart. She's just classy and elegant and steadfast and true blue. She wants to walk again someday, and I know she will. I want her to dance again. I know she will.
Even sitting in my wheelchair, life does not have to be perfect to be wonderful.